Dear ladies and gentlemen, welcome here and online to our second filtration workshop in this year's GeoDict Innovation Conference. My name is Philipp Eichheimer and I'm the business manager of the filtration area at Master Market. Opposite to the workflow we had yesterday, which has been on the filter elemental scale, we now focus on the filter media scale. So we'll include here the simulation of filtration on the media scale. First of all, I will give you a short overview over the workflow will be presented today. So today's plan will first of all start with an introduction. So we show the improvements of the GeoDict 2024 in the area of filtration. We'll then have a small peek on also the planned roadmap for future applications of GeoDict. And then we will go for a first presentation, which roughly is around 30 minutes, where we go step by step through all the steps we will go later on in a live demonstration. This should give the chance for all the users which are new to GeoDict to go step by step and follow the process, which we'll show later on. So we'll have some more detailed slides here. After that, we will have a small coffee break before we start in the live demonstration, where we show how to generate a structure to set up filtration simulation for the on-time filter media, as well as to have the glimpse at the new graphical user interface for electrostatics, which is new in the GeoDict 2024. And later on, also have a peek on the cloud capabilities, which also in the presentations already have been shown several times. As you may already have guessed, one of the major improvements in the GeoDict 2024 is the feature of electrostatic effects. These have been in the software for some years now, but in a current project, which we have got publicly funded, we will improve these features, make a graphical user interface to have all these features which have been in the software and are improved and added to the software will be very user-friendly on one slide. Further, we have technical improvements for the coalescence, which is in the software since 2 years. So here we have some of the features from the expert settings again, improved in the algorithm, as well as that we have improved the movement of the coalesced particles. Then next step, we improved a Forsham approximation, which allows to use values for pressure and velocities. This is often very useful when you run simulations or experiments and you gain velocities and pressure pairs. It gives you an idea how, for example, the simulations at higher flow rates would last, because mostly these are challenging measurements and also very longing simulations. So we can here keep a shortcut when you, for example, have small flow rates and also resulting pressures. You can have like an estimate using the Forsham equation to get, for example, an estimate about a very high flow rate. So this is some kind of estimation value which you have improved and accelerated in the new software. One very large improvement we had, which is already advertised in the second presentation from yesterday, is that we improved the disk usage for filter lifetime simulations significantly. So in one sample, which we show here, for example, where we have a structure with thousands times 5,000 voxels in each direction, which adds up to 5 billion voxels, the storage for 12 batches, so when we have 12 batches of particles, would have been normally in the old version of GeoDict 222 gigabytes of storage. And now by using compressed files in GeoDict 2024, this is reduced to 19 gigabytes in total. So we write here compressed files, so the results are unchanged. It's the same results you obtain as in the previous versions. And by reducing the disk usage by 91%, we also, as less data has to be written, reduce the runtime to 12.5% for the filter lifetime simulations. This is not only applicable for EDIDICT. So FilterDict and EDIDICT will have these features. And I think in the future, more of the modules will gain this kind of feature, if not already happened, like in Flow, so for example. Using this feature, you save valuable storage time and space, and this can instead be used for further simulations or at a time to gain knowledge on other topics. Another feature which has been developed in the last year is the adsorption in EDIDICT. So this is in a preliminary state. So we have like here a geo app in which we can use. What has been implemented was mainly a linear driving force model, which has not been so far in GeoDict. And this uses then the ability to calculate breakthrough curves. Here, applying the Langmuir and Toss adsorption isotherms, there are way more, but we chose these two as they are most well known to the community. For example, what we see here on the very left-hand side is one animation of, for example, where some material moves through a nanoscale structure. And we see here in red parts where the concentration is very high of the reactant. So here, for example, the positions where molecules or some odors or some other particles can be adsorbed are very filled, and particles where and positions where it's blue and green are still open for an adsorption. The resulting curve we see on the right-hand side is a so-called breakthrough curve. So we see that, for example, at the beginning, a lot of adsorbent can still be adsorbed as the concentration is nearly to zero. And then it increases over time. And at the end, we have a concentration at the outlet of 100%. So most of the adsorbent cannot be adsorbed anymore because all positions are blocked. And this would be then a time to either replace the filter or, for example, would be a point to improve here. Applications we have here is classical cabin air filter, fuel cell filtration, water purification everywhere where you can, for example, use activated carbon, sewer lights, and so on in the application. Also a small peek on the roadmap of the filtration. So as already advertised, we want to give you a small idea what are the capable developments in the near future. As the project is still ongoing for electrostatics, we have so far implemented a basic electrostatic decay functionality. This will be improved. So we will work here together with the UTA in Duisburg in a publicly funded project. They do all the measurements for us, and we try to gain the knowledge with them together to develop some electrostatic decay functionalities for electrate filter media. Furthermore, of course, as we deal with the UTA, we also want the validation with experiment for both mechanical and the electrostatic efficiency. And last but not least, we also have point for polarization, for example, which could be implemented into GeoDict. As already mentioned, applications here, cabin air filters, room air purifiers, face masks, and so on, everywhere we need clean air for breathing. Then also already said the adsorption. So here, the adsorption, of course, should be further improved. We also will feature, for example, desorption, so that particles, for example, which are already adsorbed can be also desorbed again. And very far in the future, we also work on a pure Eulerian adsorption solver. So moving from the Lagrangian to the Eulerian. As also mentioned already, this will be part of for activated carbon, sewer lights, carbon capture applications. In the field for coalescence, which in the software for 2 years, we're still in the work for validation with the different systems. So far, we have working with the oil and air system, but here, for example, can be also an idea to have fuel filters and so on as one of the data, and we are looking here for validation data. And last but not least, the coalescence still only performable on the media scale. So here also would be the idea to extend this on the filter element scale. And one big implementation, which is in the plannings for the next versions of the software is the implementation of LES simulations. So this is the large eddy simulations, which then also take into account, because until now we are restricted to laminar flow regimes, so Stokes and Navier-Stokes. And with LES, we also would have the chance to simulate turbulent behavior, which, for example, in filter element applications where we have air or helium or some other gases with high flow rates, are quite common in this sense. So also we'll extend our parts here in the element scale, for example. Then I will start with the general motivation. So two points to consider before we dive into the workflow. As I think most of you already know, and as we work in the filtration or industry, one key point is the air pollution we are facing. So by some of the parts we have here, air pollution is the greatest external threat to human life, according to the Air Quality Life Index in 2023. And another statement also is that 99% of the world's population was living in places where the World Health Organization air quality guidelines were not met. So these are two points which in the future will be addressed by politics and, for example, here then very recent declaration on climate and health, where it is signed by 120 countries to reduce the air pollution significantly. So to sum it up, air filtration is key for saving lives worldwide in the future. And the industry for air filtration will face constantly increasing standards for also industry and indoor air quality. So these are two points we would tackle here in this regard. A second point to consider, as already mentioned, is then sustainability and also the energy consumption for the air filtration. So HVAC systems, for example, are one of the most consuming servers worldwide. So here it's also parts for the heating and cooling, but also filtration takes the part here. For example, filters which could operate at lower pressure drops or extended lifetime could benefit or like take part when we want to reduce the footprints we have. As less filter media would have been produced, we could, for example, use the filter media longer in service. So these are parts which we would address here. So to sum this effects up, we could reduce the energy consumption using optimized filters and, for example, reduce operational costs in general. So, for example, if filter or the pressure drops in general are lower, which has a direct feedback to the operational costs and ultimately lower the CO2 emissions when, for example, less filters need to be produced and stay longer in service. This brings us to the topic why we want to use electrostatics. So an electrate filter media, for example, are applicable for the HVAC system and cabin air common filters. And it works on the principle to attract particles and trap them in the structure. And electrostatic charged materials attract and hold charged particles and trap them beyond the pore structure. So classical to the mechanical filtration, where we purely rely on the pore structure, electrostatic filters have the ability to bring efficiencies, for example, beyond the pore structure. So it's quite interesting on that. So this gives a high efficiency with a low pressure drop, as, for example, we can manufacture materials with larger fiber sizes and have it still the same filter efficiency. Challenges for the electrate filter media so far, for related to product designs, one major point which needs to be considered is the uniformity. So, and the same also for charge stability. So, for example, if the filter media is produced, it loses over time, depending on the circumstances, humidity, and so far, its ability of the electrostatic charge, and therefore the filtration efficiency decreases until it reaches the mechanical, and then later on the clogging mechanisms then increases again the filter efficiency. But in overall, to improve this performance, we still don't know very much, and we don't have the insights from measurements so far, as we only, from what we got, is the idea that only electric potentials can be measured. And the loss of efficiency is related to several parameters. One, of course, is high humidity, temperature, aging. So for example, when particles are clogged and touch each other, so for example, the electrostatic charge can also be discharged in this regard, or exposure to certain chemicals, and many more parameters which need to be taken in consideration. So why we then want to go for digitalization workflows? So at first, experiments struggle to measure precisely the electrostatic charges. So where are some electrostatic charges distributed? Until now, we only have electric potentials, which are measured above the filter media. Next then is the reproducibility of the measurements. So once you measured, the reproducibility of several measurements is quite hard to maintain. And of course, it's therefore also hard to perform single parameter studies to see which effect of the electret filter media is most prominent. Using simulations, this knowledge can be achieved, as it's possible to switch several effects on and off to see the overall effect of the performance, after, of course, a general validation with measurements beforehand. This is a great ability that we are able to understand the fundamentals of the electrostatic charge in more details, that allows us to modify it with a certain target to enhance the performance. Furthermore, we have the ability in simulation to optimize and scale digital experiments, as shown here on the right-hand side in the sketch. This is key to save vast of material and energy costs by trial and error tests. And running simulations in parallel in the cloud 24/7 has an additional advantage to significantly reduce time to market performance, which is very important when keeping pace with the new standards of air quality. In the next couple of slides, I will go a bit of the basics of GeoDict, how we simulate flow and filtration, and also then go parts on how we calculate the electrostatic charges in GeoDict. We simulate filtration in GeoDict in so-called batches. So we always have, as under point one, some filter model of some non-woven structure, for example. In the first step, we then use Stokes or Navier-Stokes equations to calculate the flow field and pressure distribution, for example. And then we let a set of particles into the structure, which travel along the streamlines and can be distorted by either drag, diffusion, or electrostatic forces. Here we offer, of course, the option to have a single pass, so where the particle size distribution stays constant over each batch, or for example, when we deal, for example, with oil applications, multipass, so where, for example, small particles which are not filtered are put again back to the starting particle size distribution. So over time, we change the particle size distribution, and the smaller particles which are not filtered are enhanced in concentration. After all particles are either filtered, so detected on a surface, or left the domain, the particles which are filtered become part of the structure. And as in the following, some of the particles may clog some pathways, and the flow field could have changed in this regard. We recompute the flow field and then again lead another set of particles into the structure, which then gives us the feedback that, of course, we first of all have the depth filtration, so the depth of the filter media is clogged, and later on we also settle a cake filtration on top of that. Regarding the flow field, I will just go a bit of the CFD and not too much on the equations. You are not necessarily to understand all of these equations, this is done in a software. So you just need to choose the equation and don't deal with the equation. Just what we know so far and apply in the software is that we use here, as highlighted, the Navier-Stokes equations. So where we have the conservation of momentum and mass as a set of equations. And of course, what we apply on the filter or like the fiber surface is that the velocities on the fiber surface are zero. In the case, in basic case, we allow also to have velocity on the fiber surface when, for example, we deal with very small nanofibered or nano-sized fibers. This is then called a slip length boundary condition. As for example, when fibers are in the range of 80 nanometers or 100 nanometers, this can be also in the in comparison with the mean free path of air, for example, which is 68 nanometers. So here we need to consider then the slip length boundary condition. But as we move for larger scales with micro-sized fibers, we can neglect this kind of feature and still be with a non-slip boundary condition. Furthermore, we assume, of course, incompressibility. So our fluids cannot be compressed. And we have time independent steady state flow in our software. And we, so far, use Newtonian fluids. So the viscosity in our simulation remains linear with applied stress on it. The particle filtration mechanisms, I think most of you guys know all these kind of mechanisms, but just what we do in the in GeoDict after the velocity and pressure field is calculated. We use state-of-the-art numerical solvers in GeoDict to do the particle tracking also. As already mentioned, these particles can be affected by drag, diffusion, electrostatics, which leads to one or more of these following particle filtration mechanisms. Depending on collision models or applied forces or activated forces in general, these can of course differ in your sample. So for example, if you don't simulate diffusion, of course the diffusion capture is also not applied onto the model. The same for electrostatics and so on. So, but we offer all these kind of particle filtration mechanisms. And over the batches, we always have the clogging of particles, which block pathways, which later on will also in one of the slides with a project will be interesting. One force, which you may have guessed, which is key today, is the electrostatic force we are calculating in GeoDict. Also, don't want to go into that detail for the equations here, but we have two forces which we calculate. The one is the dielectrophoretic force, DEP. And we use the Poisson equation to calculate the electric potential, from which the gradient is then the electric field. And this is the first equation, which is then the most important. So the actual force which we calculate is dependent on the charge of the particles, the electric field which we calculated, and the force of the dielectrophoresis. And as we can see here on the sketch on the right-hand side, if, for example, particles have a positive charge, they move along with the electric field. And if they're negatively charged, they are attracted to the electric field. The surroundings we are developing this feature is that we have a publicly funded project in development where we develop an add-in for the FilterDict media module in the goals of for 2 years. The aims we have, which is in close collaboration with the Utah, will be the general validation of experimental measurements. So what we do, of course, on the side of Math to Market will be like to implement electrostatic decay functionality. As so far, this is not tested measurementally or from experimental side. We will improve existing features. So particle charge, fiber charge is already in the software. Of course, we want to improve this, the performance and the precision. We will in one step verify with other simulation software, which we'll show in the next slide. And validate, of course, the mechanical and the electrostatic filtration with experiments conducted at Utah. And this allows us in total to gain new insights about the phenomena of electrostatics, which so far, I would say, lack a bit of details. One previous sample, as the project is still young, I want to show is a first verification with ANSYS Fluent software on a single fiber. So we have here just a single fiber and not a complete, more complex fiber structure. And we see very good results. So what we see here is the particle diameter on the x-axis and the filtration efficiency on the y-axis. And we see that, for example, with the electrostatics, so we have here the mechanical efficiency activated, so mechanical filtration. We have the electrostatics with the Coulomb force and the direct electrophoresis, both activated. And we see that we have very good agreement of all particle sizes with ANSYS Fluent and the equations solved here. The next step, which is now in preparation, is to verify on a more complex fiber structure. So here have a set of fibers, which we again validate with ANSYS Fluent. And on the experimental side, we have various electrate filter media from various with the project partner. And here we conducted micro CT images, which are now in the process of being digitalized in GeoDict, and hope I can keep you updated in the next couple of months for positive news regarding the validation for both the mechanical and using also electrostatic features in GeoDict. Now we'll go for the second part. So we'll go briefly over all the intermediate steps, which will be presented in the live demonstration. As we also have participants in the audience online or out here, which are rather new to the software, I will also give some short basic instructions. But overall, this part should prepare you such that you are follow the live demonstration without further issues. First of all, as always, we just give a first overview of the content of the live demonstration. We will first start with the generation of a fiber structure using our fiber geo module, explaining also some basics about the module. So what kind of fibers we can generate and what are the capabilities of the module. Just a sneak peek for this. We then proceed with a geo app to modify the charge distribution on the fiber structure. So here we have different states. You can distribute fibers on the filter media, which is new in GeoDict 2024. And then from the feedback we received, we will directly dive also on the filter media module to simulate filtration. So here we'll focus, of course, on the individual steps, but the main point here is to show the electrostatics graphical user interface. Here you want to, what for example, are the options for particle charge, fiber charge, dielectric phoretic force, and then last but not least, also have a peek on the electrostatic decay functionality. And as already promised in the beginning, we will also have a look on cloud capabilities, as we just conducted a very small parameter study to show some of the effects you could, for example, address using this kind of workflow and electrostatics in GeoDict. The fiber geo module is our structure generator for fiber structures. We have a large variety of fiber types and fiber parameters such as orientation, thickness, and curliness, which we can define. So there are nearly no limitations for the fiber structure to enter parameters. Furthermore, we are able to add binder to the structure, as is often used. Also gradient densities for media. So for example, when fibers are distributed in a gradient way, we can layer structures. So there is a lot of room to design and to generate your filter media. Also in cases for the fibrous media, We have the opportunity to analyze samples using FiberFind AI. So for example, if the statistical parameters of the filter media are unknown, you can conduct micro-CT, FIB-SEM, used then in the software, and then with our FiberFind AI, you get exactly the input parameters which you need to create a digital twin. More on this generation, I think it's now a session which is at the same time, but have here workflow of my colleague Andreas Krieser, how to use the results of FiberFind AI to generate a digital twin, which has exactly the same stochastical parameters as the original micro-CT scan, and this allows then for optimization routines in the following. When we go for FiberGeo, we have, as addressed here under point one, most of the parameters which we use in the software will be default, so we don't want to spend much time here. You can specify a numerical domain, voxel size, which is interesting, for example, when dealing with fibers. So the voxel length, of course, should resolve the fiber several times. In our case, we have always the rule of thumb, which is a rough 5 voxels for the smallest fiber. We specify an overlapping method and also a grammage as a stopping criterion. Either can be grammage or also the solid volume fraction, which is mostly used. Of course, we can also have a fixed set of fibers, but mostly the grammage and solid volume fraction are more closer to production input parameters in this regard. When we go for the fiber options itself, we can select different fiber types. This can be either, for example, the fiber type itself. So we can have straight fibers, hollow fibers, curved fibers, and so on. So there are various fiber types you can use in the software. And of course, you can intermix both of them. So you have different mixtures of fibers of different types, which gives you a great flexibility in this regard. Of course, diameters, orientations, everything can be adjusted to the parameters you have in the production or you obtain from micro-CT images. And then we have very last slide. So mostly we need to specify, if not possible, does not necessarily be needed in the CFD calculations, but mostly when, for example, fibers touch, we always, or GeoDict always gives a feedback of an overlap. So, and for a CFD, it doesn't too much fall into consideration, but here we call, for example, will just small set a rule that, for example, everything which is overlapping red and green phase would be the resulting red phase. So we get rid of the overlap directly in the beginning. In the next steps, we then will use the fibrous media, which we generated with FiberGeo, and then can set different stages or status of electrostatics. These can, for example, as we have different productions such as hydro charging, triboelectric, corona charging, and so on, the charge distribution may be different in each case. So, and as from the experiments only, the electric potentials can be measured. We do not have a precise idea on how the charges are distributed along the fibers, which is essentially an input parameter we need for the simulations itself. So using this tool, it's possible to generate several structures and compare the simulation results against experiments. And this allows us to deepen the understanding of electrostatic charge status for the fibers. Depending on the production or type of the fiber, the electrostatic charges are distributed differently. In our case, we have three types which we can specify the electrostatic charges on the fibers, which is in our case the layered, so where we have, for example, two layers of filter media with different charges. We have a striped, so where we, for example, imagine that you have one positive and one negative side of the fiber, and we have some kind of random distribution, so where, for example, we could imagine that the charges are not distributed equally but more in a random fashion, and see the effects each of the status has on the resulting filtration efficiency. When we then move from the electrostatic charges, which we distributed over the fibers, we then open filtered media. So simulate the efficiency or the filter lifetime. We as first always specify some simulation criterion. For example, in this case can be also the stopping criterion you have also in your experiment. We set the flow settings to our needs. We also keep here the defaults in GeoDict, as they mostly are suitable for filter media applications. Specify then, of course, mean flow rate, which is the main parameter which we enter here. And then in the live demonstration, we'll also further go over the some subtabs we have here, but I will keep the focus on the electrostatics. So here now, this is the new electrostatics graphical user interface for filter efficiency. So just when we have a clean set of particles, we move to the filter media. We can set, of course, activate the electrostatic effects, set particle charge and material charge, and activate, if necessary, the dielectrophoretic force, and specify the corresponding relative permittivity, which is the input parameter which we need for the dielectrophoresis. When we, for example, then move to the next step for the interaction model, we need to set, of course, the collision model. So what happens when particle hits the surface? Is it caught at the first touch, or do we have sieving here that particles can bounce on the fiber surfaces? We can also set, of course, when we want to save surface charge, as we activated the electrostatics, we can here set a surface charge in this regard, and also specify particle densities, which can be different for each particle type or can be the same for each particle. So these are then options which we specify directly to the particles. More on the details, so on tabs like size distribution and so forth and so on, we'll have on the live demonstration, where we just go over all of the tabs in a quick fashion to give you an idea about the capabilities in filtered media. So now, as an example, I want to move on to a small parameter study we conducted. We use in our case, for example, when we want to investigate just electrical charges on fibers, the effect of different fiber charges. We can also change, of course, the pattern if needed. But in the first case here, what we see is the pure mechanical efficiency. So we have no charges at the fibers, so just red and green, but they don't have charge on the fibers, so we stay purely mechanical. We see that, for example, here the efficiency by count is 36.6%. And then as we switch on the same fiber charge on both sides, so both sides have then the same fiber charge, we see that the efficiency is 100%, so all the particles are directly captured. And then on the last part, we have the opposite fiber charge. So we have one part of the fiber which has a fiber charge, and on the other side, we have the negative fiber charge. And we see that, for example, the efficiency is less than in the mechanical filtration, which is due to the repulsion, for example, on the other side of the fibrous media. So showing even a worse efficiency. Also one slide just to show, because the dielectric force maybe not a value which is present to everyone here. So the dielectric phoretic force is a force which, for example, can partially charge uncharged particles when they enter an electric field. So for example, when we have a strong electric field and particles which can be charged in this regard and have a certain size, then the dielectrophoresis can be very efficient. Here the simulation we performed, we see two curves, so it also diameter here on the x-axis and on the y-axis the efficiency. And we see if we don't have the electrophoresic forces activated, that the total efficiency by count is not very high, so 2.8% is not a filter you want to use. And if we activate the dielectric force, we see that the efficiency significantly increases. And this is due to the fact that the dielectric fluorophoresis is most active when we have, dominant, where we have particles in the range of 1 to 10 micrometers. So for particles which are larger than the 10 micrometers, other effects are more dominant than the dielectric force, so the effect is neglectable. And for particles which are smaller, they are very hard to partially charge, so also we have here a less dominant effect. So this would be one idea, for example, to have electrostatic charges in the filter media to see just the effect of the dielectric fluorophoresis force in your filter media. Then to move also for the electrostatic decay, which is now also in the software in GeoDict 2024. This started off with an initial idea from the FETI Testing and Research Institute in Seoul, and I think most of the work is done by Li Ping, sitting also here. And just want to phrase the initial setup. So we got the curve here in orange, what we see. So we have on the X the challenged mass, and on the Y the penetration in percent. And penetration is 1 minus the efficiency. So when we have a very low penetration with a high efficiency. So what we see in the beginning for this electret filter media, we see that the efficiency is very high because electrostatic forces are still acting. But with continued loading, the efficiency decreases as the electrostatic decay gets less and less. And then we have a turning point where then the penetration is the highest, so the efficiency is the lowest. And then, of course, the efficiency increases due to the clogging, which then takes over and is dominant. So the media is then to some extent filled in or like loaded in the depth, and then this increases the filter efficiency again, which gives this kind of significant curve. And what the other three curves are the of GeoDict in, I think, 2022. So we see just a steady increase in the efficiency due to clogging. Our functionalities were not able to reproduce this behavior, so we need to do something about this. And the new functionality, which we show here, so it's still the same curve from the Research Institute, but what we see here, especially highlighted with the red circle, is we see we have an electrostatic filter media at the beginning, and then due to the loading, the efficiency decreases due to decay. And then later on, in the rest of the curve, of course, we need to have the clogging mechanisms correct, but the focus was here to the decay functionality, which is validated with measurements for electret filter media, and we could reproduce this behavior very well in the new GeoDict 2024. As already mentioned several times, the model will be further developed in the publicly funded project. So the version which we have in the software now, maybe not the last versions we have been implemented. Either we have more solutions or improved solutions, but we will see this in 1 or 2 years. But in general, it's possible in GeoDict now to have like a first electret filter media, which is then discharged, or like the electrostatic effect gets less and less when particles enter the material, and which is also validated with measurements. Also some small outlook for the electrostatic decay. So we have here, this is directly from the graphical user interface in GeoDict. Also used a lot of literature to develop some kind of equation which references to the electrostatic decay. So here we can show that, for example, exposures to heat, humidity, solvents, and other results can have an effect on the electrostatic decay. So just to highlight one of the parameters, so we have like a minimum, like the epsilon minimum, which is like the minimum surface charge, which is allowed for the, or like set for the filter media. We have, of course, a decay factor, which can be chosen to the, for example, exposure, which the electret filter media is facing. And of course, a variable for time, deposit dust, and solid volume fractions. So this is like something we need from the experiments setting here, the correct parameters to have like a decay functionality, which then also can reproduce the measurements itself. So for the simulation of the electrostatic forces in GeoDict, to sum things up, we have three options. First of all, the filter surface charge can be set, as has been already in the software. Particle surface charge and decay model, which have all been in the software, and the decay model new implemented. So you see here a screenshot of the full graphical user interface. So in the snapshots I already showed, we only had the efficiency. And in efficiency, of course, we don't have a decay functionality, as we just let one set of particles through the media. But for the lifetime, as we have several sets, of course, the decay functionality can be chosen and is validated. And future improvements will be in this regard, of course, verification with other simulation software, validation with measurements, both mechanical and electrostatic. And also one of the key parts to have like the filter lifetime behavior when we have this decay functionality. And one point which is to discuss is the polarization, as this has been one of the features of some of the filter media and filter element producers to maintain the electrostatic effects for a longer time, so that you charge the particles beforehand and you have the filter media also charged. So this is at the moment the how to say, the decision for choice to maintain the electrostatic force reliable for a high efficiency. Some slides also now for the cloud computing, which will be conducted or which we show the results of. The general advantage of the GeoDict cloud is to further improve your productivity in the product development. By default, simulations are performed sequentially, so which takes into account that simulations run 24/7, which is a great benefit. But sometimes large-scale simulations need more computational power, and classical workstations or parameter studies should simply run in parallel. For example, if you have a very large parametric study, you just don't want to run them sequentially if there is opportunities for running them in parallel. And for these demands, for example, is the cloud the tool of the future? And could imagine, for example, running a set of equations at the same time of one simulations. I think Andreas like pointed this out in his presentation quite clearly, what the capabilities are. And the most of the scaling factors is that you can save a lot of money instead of trying manual try and error procedures, which cost material energy. So systematic testing is the key to only find the promising prototypes, which need to be taken into account and then can be directly put in a test bench for validation and then also in the next step for production. I think this is one of the keys. In GeoDict, as I think also in some of the presentations today, we have a run in the cloud button. So we have the opportunity directly in GeoDict to use the cloud. So we don't need to go to some other platform. It's directly in GeoDict. When you run to run the simulations, you have the option to have it locally running, in a job queue running, or directly in the cloud. So you can, yeah, very comfortably select directly from a wide range of machines what you think is suitable. You can specify your timeout. You can specify the version of the software and so on and so forth. So everything is more or less built in the graphical user interface. When you then selected start, we get the status of all running simulations. So we see if there are green, red, or yellow, and this gives direct feedback on if some machine should be stopped or so on. So this is a great benefit. You don't need to wait for the results to finish at some point. You just direct feedback in this regard. And if everything is green, this is a good sample, and you can download these structures directly locally and then analyze this data either directly in GeoDict or also in other platforms. And yeah, after running the cloud instances, I just want to go over the results we obtained. So in our case, we just run three configurations as already advertised. We have one structure which is random charge distribution, layered and striped. Once this gives in total 21 simulations, which we investigate. And as a reference case, which we have in the following plots, is here the purely mechanical filtration. So we have this case where no charges on the fibers is activated, diffusion is active, and we have used just a standard phase velocity of 0.1 micrometers per second. Just want to highlight this because in the following plots I will show, we'll always have the green dashed line, which is then the reference case, so where we have the pure mechanical filter efficiency, and will change the status of the fibers and the strength of the charge on the fibers and see the effect it has on the filter efficiency, for example, which then gives some feedback in this regard for optimization. When we, for example, have a random charge distribution in the sum, we see here on the left-hand side, so we see always on the x-axis the diameter and on the y-axis the efficiency we have. As said already, the green dashed line is just pure mechanical. So we see also, for example, then when we have for material one, so the green or the red, and material two, electrostatic charge of 1e minus 8, there is not really an improvement. So can be also purely mechanical in this regard. We see with moving or like increasing the electrostatic charge to 1e minus 7, we have just a very slight increase in the efficiency. But then when we move to minus 6, we have a very strong increase in nearly 100% of filter efficiency. So somehow the sweet spot is between 1e minus 7 and 1e minus 6 for both materials. So these are some drawbacks you could, for example, see, because we will have in the when we moved in for other layers, for example, as here, for example, layered structure was when we emphasize, for example, that we have two layers and both have different charges or like different strong charges. We see, for example, that when we have then the 1e minus 7, we already have a very high efficiency in cases, for example, for random distribution. We don't see this kind of effect in this regard. So, for example, where would be here the sweet spot in thickness of the media and in charge of the single media, which, for example, in production would be easier when you have just two medias of the same or like different charges stacked on top of each other to improve the efficiency. And coming to the striped setup, which is said to be one of the very asked from our customers and clients. So we had various questions about some kind of electrostatic charge distribution in this way, so that one side of the fiber is positive and the other side is negative. So here what we see is in the middle we see already the green dashed line, and we see if we increase, for example, the efficiency with both of sides, so both have the same charge, the red and the green, we see of course the efficiency increases. And as we, for example, see that we have one negative and one positive, the efficiency even drops. So it's less than the mechanical. This is also some interesting behavior. So it seems that also repulsory effects are quite strong depending on the strength of the fiber charge and of course also for the particles. So this is something just from performing simulations, you can have a feeling what, for example, the status would be on the filter efficiency and what could be, for example, drawbacks for your product development on the filter media. So take home message, digitalize your product development to design and produce innovative next generation filters. So I think the message for air pollution and for energy reduction is clear. We give you a tool to run filter media simulations with different sets of particles, charges, and fiber charges, hoping to get new insights which we can use in the product development. Because I think electrate filter media, if they're reliably produced and everyone knows how each parameter affects the efficiency, can be one of the keys in the air filtration. And just for demonstration, so here what do we want to take home? So we can use GeoDict to understand the fundamentals of electrostatics using GeoDict. We can save material and time in development cycles by using, for example, systematic studies to test parameter ranges which you just don't want to test by trial and error. This saves time and material. And our workflow is sustainable, digital, and scalable in each regard. So what we show here is the runtime on a workstation where we have this 21 simulations running in sequential, which is 15 hours, and in the cloud running all at the same time, it's 43 minutes. So just by the numbers, that seems to be much. But when we think that the factor here is 20 and think of simulations, we're talking about, for example, each simulation lasts 1 week. So it would be 20 weeks when you run them sequentially, and in the cloud would be 1 week. So you save 3 or 4 months of time. So the factor seems here in this regard for a small study, quite small, but for larger studies can be very significant. So welcome to the second part of the workflow. As you can already see, we moved to the software itself. As we already have some new guys in the audience and also online, we'll just keep also some detailed information about the software itself. So in the beginning, we always see here the emphasized workflow we have from import and model of structure, analyze, prediction, and export. In our case, as we already showed in the slides, we will first import or like generate a structure. So here, fiber structure, just from without any large specifications. Just we'll go through all the details you could potentially change in the simulation software to generate the material you have in your application. Then we'll go for the filter media or like in the Geo app to first distribute charges. We show here all of the different charge distribution status we have in the software so far. Then we move to the filter media module to set up a flow simulation and a filtration simulation. And here we'll point especially on the electrostatic graphical user interface, which is new in GeoDict 2024. And then at the very last, because I pre-computed the results for you, we don't need to wait here, even if it takes just a couple of minutes. But just to shorten the time, we'll also load the results of the efficiency simulations and then show also some visualizations and drawbacks you can also obtain from the visualization feedback. To generate a fiber structure, we always click here on the model tab. So we have all the structure generators here. For our case, we now use the fiber geo, but we have all kinds of generators which we can use, ranging from foams and woven structures, pleats, when you are specialized on the filter element scale also. And then by clicking on the fiber geo, we switch here in the module section. So we have all the options now to choose from in fiber geo. We just want to create some fibers. So we hit here on edit and we have the first window that opens where you can specify first of all the domain we are working in. So is there a specific size of the domain it should cover, which is the numerical resolution. So the voxel length here, which we need to change as already mentioned. When we, for example, want to simulate fiber with 1 micrometer, we would change this here to 0.2, as we mostly have this rule of thumb that 5 voxels should at least resolve the smallest fiber. So here for the voxel length, you always need to consider your fiber structure, which you want to simulate to have like a very good representation of each of the fibers. Then we have the generation overlap mode. So here we can specify if we want to have an overlap of fibers or if we want to prohibit this, mostly for CFD and for filtration, we can stick with the allow fiber overlap because in the CFD, anyway, all the solid particles or like solid parts for materials ID don't have any velocity in the computation on top. So it doesn't depend if we have overlap or a different fiber here, but for example, for deformation, this would be, for example, a point which need to be addressed. As here, for example, also the material parameters for stiffness and stuff like this go into the calculation. Then we can, for example, also specify a stopping criterion. We will stick here with the 10% of solid volume fraction, but can be also have a grammage, for example, with us in filter media productions, quite the standard in this kind of regard, but at least to have some volumetric information, which we can use here. And then what, for example, is also interesting, I just want to point it out, is our random seed. So this is more or less like a random number, and which changes with each iteration, and just gives some statistics that, for example, when you want to do some optimization, we always want to change all the random seed to some numbers just to be sure that the stochastics are the same, but results remain constant, and we don't have some kind of very lucky configuration, which is not benchmarked with stochastics in this regard. When moving to the second tab, we can specify here the fibers. So in our case, just keep everything on default. But what we have here is a set of two types of fibers distributed by 50-50. So 50% is red and 50% is green. We could, for example, add more fiber types. I think in the recent version is up to 5 different fiber types. So here in our case, this is now the infinite circular, but we also could specify from our fiber types tab below. So we can have short ones where we also have to specify then, of course, the length of the fiber. For infinite, this is not necessary as they just go directly straight through the whole domain. We have cellulose fibers, which are a little bit curvy, elliptical, where we have not a perfect roundish shape. The same have we for curved. So here for the curved ones, we need to specify then some kind of curliness. It's a kind of tricky parameter, but where you can specify to which degree a fiber should be curved. If it's very smooth global curving, or it's really like kind of spaghetti type. So this would be, for example, something you could emphasize here. So I think this gives you a great idea of how specific you can be in FiberGeo to generate and to resolve your filter media which you have in the application. The same appeals for then the diameter and orientations. So it seems that we have here a constant. We leave this for just demonstration purposes, but the diameter can be also here changed to either be changed uniformly, or mostly what you have is a Gaussian or probability distribution where you have either from the measurement in the laboratory or from other softwares, for example, some probability distribution, because the fibers don't have mostly one fixed diameter, they mostly change to a certain range. So this can be, for example, also input here, just to be as precise as possible for the structure generation. And this is, for example, some of the parameters you obtain, for example, also with FiberFind AI. So here you get like the probability distribution, which you can directly input here in FiberGeo. For the fiber types, they can also distribute between two separate fiber types. So this is also possible. So what you analyze with FiberFind AI can directly be input here as a parameter in FiberGeo. The same also we have for the orientation. So here we can have an isotropic orientation, which where the fibers are isotropic in each directions. Mostly what is in the application more feasible is to have like an anisotropic direction. Mostly what you would enter here is in production machine and cross direction, which are two parameters, which for example was always that you have a preferred orientation depending on the production mechanism. So this is something you would change here in this regard. We just stick with all of the defaults. And as I already mentioned, we will get rid here of the default. So we just increase here a number of overlapping rules and just say, okay, if red and green overlap, we should just assign it to red. So we don't have any overlap in the structure, but as already mentioned for the CFD itself, like computation of flow and filtration, it doesn't make too much of an effort just for deformation simulations and so on, where the material properties are very important. We can hit okay, and we just generate the structure. We can directly go through the three-dimensional view, and we see now here the default structure we have in GeoDict, which is composed now of two types of fibers. So we have the material ID 1 and 2, which are both glass fibers, and the material ID 0, which is air, so it's in between and not displayed. It's the fluid we are emphasizing. And what we do now in the second step is we want to use this generated structure, and we want to use, in our case, the GeoApp, which is new in GeoDict 2024. And we used in here material IDs to specify the material charge. So what happens in the software itself? So we have then here, for example, two material IDs, and we assign charges to the material ID. So this is just for the more experienced users here in the audience. That's why, for example, also in the beginning, the fibers have been red and green in the presentation. Now we will also use this and feature to post-process more or less the structure and to assign the fibers charges to each of the fibers. To move for the GeoApp, we have either the GeoApp tab on top of here, and then we can, depending on the modules you are searching, you can more or less go to the filter apps, which we have here. And then we have several apps which we already have in the stock. And here we see then also the electrostatics fibers. A second way to find the GeoApps is directly when you use the module, and it's a different way to search for it. So we would go for predict, and as we know, we use FilterDict for that. We'd go for FilterDict, and then instead of directly going for media element or complete filter, we would go here for filter GeoApps, and would be in the right section to have the electrostatics. So this is the way you find the GeoApp for electrostatic fibers. And then we can open the GeoApp by clicking here on edit. Of course, as you see, the file is also open for modifications. So in case there is some advanced user with very good Python programming skills, you can also manipulate the script file to your needs in case there are some parameters you want to fix or keep constant throughout the domain. We then open here the electrostatics GeoApp. We can specify results file name, which is obviously, and we can choose between the three different distribution modes. So the one is the random, where we have just a feature size. So this is more or less the spots we generate with the Gaussian random fields in the filter media. We have the number of material IDs, so we can have, in our case, we'll stick with two, but could be, for example, several material IDs to have like more representative. And of course, we have a random seed, which we set also here, so that the random distribution also is like with the same random seed, always the same structure, but with a different random seed. The spot size is same, but it's just stochastically changed by a random number. So for example, if you go here for statistics, this would be also parameter to validate. When we move for the layered structure, we just give the idea of how many material IDs we want to have in our structure. Can be just two, as we already showed, or I can just put here just a three to show how it would look like. Now we have here gradient structures with three media, with three layers. And we now could, for example, in the simulation for FilterDict, we could now assign the red, the green, and the yellow one a different fiber charge. So, which is in reality either that you have, for example, an entire filter media you put on top of each other with have been in production for a different electrostatic charge. So this would be, for example, the simplest case. We have three layers. One is very strongly charged and one are getting weaker and weaker. And for example, you could check in GeoDict beforehand how you could assemble these in the structure to have the best performance and tendency, very low pressure drop. Or for example, if you think that, for example, or the idea would be through the production process that, for example, the charges internally of the filter media could be charged differently. For example, when you just rub things together, how would, for example, the charges distribute that positively are on the right side and then it goes more and more negatively to the other side. So these are ideas you could tackle with this model. And then the last model we have is the striped ones. So here we can specify the width of the stripes, which of course has to be in more or less the idea for the thickness of the fibers. And we can give a direction of the stripes, which is from top down. So they're top down striped, or we can go from left, right. So they're like halved in between. Can also have this feature as as specifications. And this is what we have from the customer feedback, one of the most asked features, to have like fibers which have are divided into two parts, where you have on the one side a positive charge and on the other side a negative charge. So this is what we got from customers, that there is very high interest in this kind of feature. Also want to show this here. Just we can just override the structure. Okay, this doesn't look good. Well, let's take it. I will show a lot of the results later on from the other ones, but this is working so far. So this, for example, would have been here the random case, because this takes a little bit longer for this generation, because we first have to calculate the Gaussian random fields. In case of longer, it lasts 2 or 3 minutes. But instead of staring together for the process part of finish, we just continue with the simulation. So these are the three stages we already showed in the presentation. I think from personal point of view, this gives a quite large perspective of how you would, for example, generate media structures and then compare it directly to the efficiencies you obtain in the lab. So this is exactly what we have now. We have the efficiencies in the lab, and in GeoDict we can calculate efficiencies. So what, for example, would be the drawback is when the efficiencies for a certain type of measurements fit to each other. We have a good chance that, for example, is the fiber charge distribution in this regard, as we have in simulated in GeoDict. Then when the fibers in this regard are in a form we want to use it for the software or for the simulation of filtration, we click here under predict and stay in FilterDict, or if you have been in GeoDict, we move to FilterDict. And then we want to simulate, of course, something on the filter media. So we have two options. One is the efficiency. So we have a clean filter media and we pass a set of particles once to obtain the initial efficiencies we have on the media. Or if we want to have like some information about the particle loading itself, so we want to have the pressure drop over time, the efficiency development over time, then we, for example, you will see the filter lifetime. So this is actually what happens in an operation. And I will switch to this just to show then the entire graphical user interface, as we need to keep time in mind. We also click here on edit. Just for a quick overview, we can specify the experiment as already known in the software for years. So a single pass where the particle size distribution is constant over the entire loading, or multi-pass, it changes over time. We specify again our stopping criterion and flow settings. And then we can move on to the particle step. So consider materials, sure, we can change to all of the physical parameters we need. So we specify the fluid to be oil, or so they have predefinitions in any regard. The same for the fibrous media, so it can be polymeric or glass fibers. We can specify this in the software without any problems. And then when we move for the particles, we want to focus here on, first of all, the movement. So here we can control the diffusion. So we can switch it on and switch it off. We have also the possibility, in case there's further need or advanced users, a particle UDF, as you know maybe from different softwares, where, for example, you have some other additional forces you want to add to the particles. Gravity would be one, for example, or some other forces. You can need some C++ skills here, and then can put your own UDF in the simulation. But yeah, as want to emphasize, we can include the electrostatic effects. So this is the new tab you will see in the GeoDict 2024. So when we activate the electrostatic effect, we can set the particle charge. So no charge means particles are not charged. We can have a proportional charge to the surface area. So the larger the particles, for example, the smaller the charge in this regard. We can also set charges individual per particle type. So depending what you measured in the laboratory, for example, when you have a different size, which has a different specific charge, this can be also one possibility. Or you could, for example, use it just a Boltzmann random distribution, depending on the particles which are in the application and what you need. The same for the material charge. So we can, for example, have for the material charge individual per particle type. So this is something what we, for example, used in the study I showed in the slides, when we fixed for material one and for material two the fiber charge. So this is something you would, for example, choose here. And then you have in the interaction model the option here to have a surface charge in Coulomb per square meter. So this is something you would then specify to either the green or the red material ID directly. So in our case, and as we have a random distribution, we would then have the green, for example, a negative, and the red one would be then either corresponding the same positive to have like an entirely neutral filter media, or if, for example, you have like some kind of polarization, you would have one parameter higher than the other one. So this is something you could, for example, specify here. Of course, size distribution matters. So in our case, we have predefined ISA 1 to ISA 4, but there's also always the room for individual particle size distributions, especially when you compare with measurements. I cannot emphasize enough that it's always important when comparing to measurements that also the same particle size distribution needs to be used when having the particle size which has been used in the measurements. And of course, we can use the decay surface charge. So here we have the sketch, which we also already showed in the slide. Enter here the parameter for the surface charge and the decay factor, which we either get from experiments where you have some kind of decay functionality and you know which kind of aging or heat has used for the stuff. We can also have later for the plotting, then of course change the decay variable to time, dust, or volume fractions of dust, something you obtain from the measurements which we need for the input here. And the same, of course, for the dielectrophoresis. We need here the relative permittivity from the fluid medium, so for air and for particles. And this depends strongly on the material you have. So for example, quartz is around 8 for the relative permittivity of particles. He had also, but in polymers is a little bit less. So in this regard, you need to specify the parameters for the electrostatics itself, which then gives you the idea what, for example, you need as input. So we still strongly need the experimental input, especially for the decay functionality. We need just some kind of measurements which you can use here in the software as input parameters. Jumping to results, or at least one of the results we have. So I already loaded, but the windows is lost. So we have, for example, some simulation already run here. So we see what the efficiency for each filter type is in the report, and I will also in a second load the particles so that we can see that, for example, particles which are I think I charged it positively attached to only one material ID, and the other one is like not touched itself. So that's also the effect and the drawbacks you could see from this are of key interest. And of course, we obtain some of the particle statistics, but most importantly, for each particle diameter, you obtain an efficiency to see which kind of particle class is most penetrating, for example, in this kind of filter. Then we'll have just the final particle track to statistics, but most importantly, for each particle diameter, you obtain an efficiency to see which kind of particle class is most penetrating, for example, in this kind of filter. Then we'll have just the final particle track to see some particles here. Maybe we can just change the Visualization here, just gonna. Oh, we can see it. So it's in green and green. So I just change maybe the ID here to. What can we do? Dark blue? No. So we see a bit better. So we have both particle types here. And what we see mostly when we look on top of each other, so most of the particles are purely attached to all of the gray material, which is in the particles are changed positively and the gray are negatively. So they are attracting each other. And the red ones you see here, most nearly no particle is attached to the red materiality, because here we have repulsive forces. And of course, if we have sieving at some point in the filter media, this can also be happening, that material or that particle is stuck here. But just from seeing of the eye, we see that the particles are only attached to the material, which is the opposite of the particle charge, for example. Of course, we here in this sample, we have the particle charge positively and not like neutral, so we have positive and negative, just to show that in this case we also see from the visual feedback already that particles are mainly attracted to the opposite part, or like polarization of the fibers. I would close the session here. Thank you for your attention and your time, and when there are questions, just feel free to reach out, book some meeting, or meet me here so we can discuss. Thank you.